Good morning, everyone. God bless you.
Good to see you all here. May we stand? Good morning, also everyone watching online. Welcome to the Celebrate Life family. God to say it. Dios te bendiga. God bless you all. How many of you had a bit of struggle last week? Good for all the rest of you. You just, we just assumed to tell the truth. Yeah, we're just blessed. Amen. You know what? I just want to encourage everyone that's watching, that's with us, just hang in there. Don't give up on the faith. Just the breakthrough will come. He is Jehovah Nissi. He is the victorious one. Amen. And we have the victory in Christ Him. So we are people of faith, right? We are children of God. And I would like to open up the service with 1 John 5:4. And I'm reading from the Amplified. For everyone is also you and me, born of God is victorious and overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has conquered and overcome the world. Our continuing, persistent faith in Jesus, the Son of God. The Passion says, for our faith is the victorious power that triumphs over the world. Isn't that good to have this word, and we have Jesus in us and the power in us? And let's just close our eyes for a moment and just imagine that Jesus is right here, because he is in us, he is present. Oh, where two or three are gathered together, he is in the midst. This is wonderful. We have the King of Kings here, the Lords of Lords, our Savior, our healer. Oh, Father, thank you so much for your Son, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you gave your life. Thank you that you died for us, you rose for us, and you'll live again, and you live in us, and we are alive in you. Hallelujah. We give you this morning all the glory, all the praise, all the honor. You're the glorious Jesus. You're the famous Jesus. You are our friend. You are our Savior, our Lord, the healer, and you are here. Oh, we love you. And we give to you all the glory, all the praise. Hallelujah to your name. We exalt the name of Jesus, the name above every name. In the name of Jesus, that there is power. And we are using it. We are children of your Almighty God. Thank you so much. Receive this worship that comes from the bottom of our hearts. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah.
Oh,
said, Amen.
place at your saving grace that you should love one such as me. Took my sin, all my guilt and shame, broke those chains and set me free. Sun for hours.
开我的一路带起。Be thankful. You can call Jesus your friend.
Amen.
Be thankful that your heart is beating. Be thankful that you're breathing.
Amen.
Be thankful that you want to say I'm right. Maybe things weren't as they once used to be. Well, be thankful for the changes. Because the Lord's working out beneath him.
For your promise.
Lord, having a heart of gratitude. And we're saying thank you.
Amen.
Can you see how the atmosphere in here is changing right now? Oh, it's the joy of the Lord that gives you the strength. And it is in His presence where we have the joy. Oh, Father, you are amazing. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And we just want to stay the whole service in that cloud, in that atmosphere of gratitude, of thank you, of joy.
Hallelujah.
Oh, you're so good. Hallelujah. And you at home, just have a good laugh also. And you here, we can have a laughing session.
Amen.
Ha! Let's go on. I want to hear your laughter a bit. Because that is good for the heart. A merry heart is as good as medicine. Okay? Let go. Let go. Just have a good laughter. Oh, Jesus and the Father and all heavens, they are looking down at you thinking, wow, look at these. Look at my sons and daughters. They are joyful.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. And in that same attitude, we take up our offerings. Because why? Anybody knows? Okay. I tell you. Because the Lord loves a cheerful, happy, joyful giver. Okay? If you don't have it in your heart, you feel obliged.
Right.
Go back, keep your offering, keep your tithes. It's a heart issue. Amen? As we are started last week with our first offerings, we continue until the second week of February. Okay, when we have wish and then we close it, so everybody has enough time to think about it, to pray about it, to calculate. It took me a while too until I received clear instruction about the first fruits, so I have mine ready next week, but if you have yours ready, or just your tithes and your offering, the basket is over there. And I just forgot to read it again. Because it's such a hard issue. From Genesis 4, and I preached last week on it. Who remembers, everybody? Yes. Genesis 4:3. And in the course of time, here we go again. Like I said last week, one, you finished, a new thing starts. That's why we're taking also up our first fruits now. Cain brought to the Lord an offering of the fruit of the ground, but Abel brought an offering of the finest, firstborn of his flock, and a fat portion. And the Lord had respect to God for Abel and for his offering. God is not a system for anybody else. He loves everybody the same. He has set the word to everybody the same way. So it is you. You need to see. You need to look deeper. What is your first fruit? And it doesn't just have to be money if you didn't earn anything. It can be helping wise, making a cake for somebody, visiting the neighbors. What is your first fruit? What is your first fruit for your children? What is your first fruit? You all listening who have grandkids. Who are your grandkids? Your grandparents can do that. What is your first fruit? So we take up the offering, the tithes, the noble offering, the seeds, and the first fruit. Amen. Let us pray. Oh, Father, we thank you so much that you see the hearts and the motives of everyone. Because we may can fool people, but we never can fool you. And I just want to say thank you that you're not a respecter of person. That you love us just as much as you love everybody else. And that we have the opportunity to give the first fruit. That we have the opportunity that we get to tithe, that we get to sow the seed. It's all for your kingdom. It's eternal. Mm-hmm. Father, as we said last week, the seed, the offering, the first fruit, just leaves our hand, but it doesn't leave the kingdom realm. We sow into your kingdom, Father, because one day this world is gone, but your word and your kingdom shall be forever. So, Father, with a joyful heart and with gratitude, we give our offerings, tithes, and first fruits to you. And we cover it in the blood of Jesus. It's for you. It's protected. It Thank you, Father God, that only you know how to multiply this. We can't figure it out. But you said there's a 30, 60, and 100 fold. And thank you. You're so good to us. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen. The basket is right there. If you want to get something, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. Before we pray for healing and before we hear the word, we pray for our leaders. Mm-hmm. Amen. But let us pray from that seat of authority. Who takes in the morning the seat of authority and prays for the family, prays for Tenerife? Okay, maybe you have never heard of it. So we go to the scripture because it's so important. You are not powerless, okay? It's not that you like, que será, será. Jesus, and you are positioned, but you need to know where you are positioned. So, I call it the seat of authority. So, if you have a special seat at home, or just imagine you sitting down, I sit down. It says in Ephesians 2:6, and that's God speaking, and He, right, God, raised us up together, that's us, with Him, when we believe, and seated us with Him in the heavenly places, because we are in Christ Jesus. So we seated far above. Where is that? Here we go. That's in the heavenlies. We are in Christ Jesus at His right hand. And it says right here in Ephesians 1:22. Far above. That's where you're seated, and that's where you say every morning, I'm taking my seat. Hallelujah. Far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, whether angelic or human, and far above every name that is named, not only in this age and world, but also in the one to come. Wow. So you take your seat in the morning, and you start praying. You start praying for the leader, the first of all prayer which you do right now, and you tell the devil where he has to go. Go from your family, go from your business, go from your work, go from your studies, from your money, from your body, in Jesus' name. You have that authority. You have the name of Jesus. And that just brings me now to first of all, we call this prayer. In 1 Timothy 2, first of all, then I urge you that petitions, specific requests, prayer, intercession, prayers for others, and thanksgiving be offered up all who are in position of high authority, so that we may live a peaceful and quiet life in all godliness and dignity. So first of all, before you pray for Auntie Rose, before you pray for your husband, before you pray for your children, you pray for the leaders. We do not criticize. Complaining is remaining, but the word of God and prayer is powerful. You release power, and that changes. Mm-hmm. So if everyone would pray, we would have a lot big, better place, I would say. So you take authority over your city where you live, over your población, over your provincia, municipal, wherever you are, wherever you're tuning in, over your city. Amen? Yeah. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we lift up before you, everyone tuning in, Lord. All these different countries, these different places, Father, but we us here, we are in the south of Tenerife. That is our place that you gave us, Lord. So we are taking our seat in Christ Jesus, far above all rule and principalities and powers and names. And we lift up before you, Father God, our government, everyone in authority, in Tenerife, in the Canary Islands, in the entire Spain, Father. Everyone who has a position in authority, in politics, in courthouses, police officers, firefighters, doctors, whoever's in authority. it is you that places people in authority. And you have a specific purpose for them to do, Father. So we just simply say, your kingdom come, your will be done in their lives on earth as it is written in heaven for them. And you kingdom of darkness, we bind you in the name of Jesus. You stop blinding our leaders. And we pray in Jesus' name that they have a clear vision from you, God. That they know exactly what to do. That they receive wisdom from you. That they get to know you as we know you, Father. That you are their Lord and their Savior. Father, touch their hearts because they are here for the people. Thank you, Father God, that you do that they do the very best. I know you do the best, and we all do the rest in praying. Guide and lead them, Father. And we just thank you that we as a church, the believers, the body of Christ, we are just so highly favored by them, around them, for them. That they know that we pray. That they know that we are behind them. That they know that we don't criticize. That they turn to us, Father. The day will come that they say, can you pray for us? We don't know how to do that. That even the police officers are turning to us and saying, we need to find this person. Can you pray? Oh, yes, we do.
Amen.
That what the body of Christ is there for. Holy Spirit, prepare the way. Oh, Holy Spirit, there is an awakening. It's going to happen. Awaken our leaders. Awaken our people here in Tenerife. This beautiful island that you brought us here. Awaken them. Awaken the sons. That they get to know you. An outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Oh, thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 God is so good. You know, when you pray, He answers your prayer. I have noticed that if it doesn't happen immediately, there's a growing process, and you grow in faith. It will happen eventually. Never doubt, never doubt. I started praying simple prayers, simple stuff that I just need to have answered. For example, with my mom. She's 84. We are here in the ministry. So I said, and it's Sunday, so I said to her, so I said to God, I have three requests today. He calls my mom. Just standing, knowing that you don't have because you don't ask. Mm-hmm. And it says, if it's in the will of God, you can ask anything in my name. John 14:12-14. Just ask me, and He will do so. So I asked, she had problems with her phone, but the phone will work again, the main line. But a friend will call on that main line and say, shall we spend some time together? And I just watches over her going out and coming back. You know what? She called just at 10 o'clock. I know you're busy, but I'm calling from my main line. Just want to tell you that the phone works. The friend just called. And we're going to spend the Sunday together. So it is that simple. Don't doubt in your heart. Just believe Him. Things that you cannot do, He can do. And it's the same thing with pray for healing. It's the same thing. Just believe that He is the healer. Believe that's not Him that sends sickness and disease. That's the life from hell. Okay? God is good and He's always good. We know that bad things are happening, but God is still good. He's always good. Amen. And I just wrote down this name. As Diane will get ready and she will pray for healing, the anointing is just up on her this morning. I can sense that she bubbled up, so she's full of faith. And you will receive that same anointing that we receive all here. The healing power just flowing through her. And you will receive, it says in Psalm 7. And He saved them from their distress, and He sent His word and healed them and rescued them from their destruction. The Passion Version is saying, God spoke the words. Be healed, and we were healed. Delivered from death's door. We shall live and not die. So you can talk about the good things the Lord has done. So get ready. Get ready for your healing. Everybody at home also get ready to receive healing today. It's available. The anointing is just flowing in here. So Diane, please, let it flow. Let the anointing just flow this morning.
Thank you. Well, Bettina, you touched on the word that we'd like to put on the screen today just before in Psalm 3. And just before that, you can see, I cried to the Lord with my voice, and he heard me from his holy hill. But before that, it says in verse 3, O Lord, you are a shield for me. And the shield is your faith. It's, and you spoke about this, about we have to put up our shield up for healing. Because God wants to heal. But we have to have that faith to believe in the miracles and to believe that God is answering those prayers. For those that you can't explain why they're going through what they're going, but they need a healing touch from the Lord. So from this day forward, keep it on your heart to keep clear anything in your heart that may hinder the healing. Especially if we want to receive a miracle. Forgiveness. We talked about that last week.
It's important.
Important to get rid of it. So that we can pray for others with a clear heart and a clear conscience. And here in the church, we know in the word it says, be kind to one another. You know, be kind to one another. And forgive one another as God in Christ forgave you. So today, if there's anything in your heart that's bubbling up now and saying, you know, that person really gets on my nerves, can't stand it anymore, I am so fed up with this island, you know, I am sick of this island because I'm sick of the government, stop. That could be hindering your prayer request for yourself or somebody else receiving their healing. All their miracles. So, are you prepared to pray? Is there anyone who needs prayer in the here? Or anyone you would like to pray for that's not on our list? Because our faith is an action. We need to act on our prayer requests.
If you can just give the little testimony about Sarah.
Oh, before yes, absolutely.
Pray, I think every grandparent, every parent will be stirred up.
You know, God is a God answers prayers and he's also in America working for us. We know that. And, you know, just praise God because we may never, ever meet this Sarai. We may never meet her. But we acted on faith and we believed that she would be made whole. And she is completely healed. She had an operation where her heart needed to be operated on, a newborn baby. And we've had a great press reports. That she's well, she's now nursing with a mother, and there is our miracle that we prayed for, and we know that God is in that healing ministry for us within the church. So again, cast down anything, says the word in 2 Corinthians, anything that's not from God. Amen. So if you feel your heart stirring up with something that's just not right, just leave it at God's, with God, and just know that your prayer is going to be answered. Your family member will receive their wholeness in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let us pray.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Father God, right now in this moment, we've put on our shield of faith, and we're believing in the power of the Holy Spirit to come and to heal us and set us free. To be made whole, Lord. Oh, Father God, you are a prayer answering God, and there's nothing that's impossible for you. And we know that right now, by the power of the Holy Spirit, all that's not from you has been cast down, shaken, and we've been stirred in the Spirit to pray for everyone that's on our prayer list, Lord. We're so grateful, Father, that we're believing that they will be made whole. That they will be set free by the power of the Holy Spirit. Your goodness and your mercy, they follow us, Lord. You are just waiting for us to step out in faith and ask and will be given to us, and seek and we shall find. And we know that you will answer these prayers. Your timing is perfect. And we praise you for this wonderful miracle this week, Lord. We are so, so grateful, Lord. Grateful for you, Lord, that you are here and you're in the midst and you're answering our prayers. And we just love you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. And we thank you, Father God, that nothing is impossible for you. Oh, Father, stir up our hearts. Stir up our spirit. Speak to us within us. If there's anything that's hindering us from receiving answered prayer, or our miracle, Lord, for our family member or our friends, oh, just speak to our hearts right now, Lord. And we step out, Lord, and we thank you, Father, that faith rises in the midst. Faith is here, and you've forgiven us one another. You've forgiven us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Maggie.
You're welcome.
And we want to hear the testimonies. The testimonies.
Yes, well,
the healings then.
Oh, amen. Yeah, of course.
That's that right, that is,
yeah, absolutely.
Even now, they can write me.
Yeah, they can write to us right now before this service is finished.
Well, you need testimonies. You have testimonies. Hey, we're all a testimony to prayer, aren't we?
We are. I mean, I think so.
I think all of us got prayed for by someone.
Yeah.
Took me a while to realise that someone was trying to make a long, long time.
Yeah.
Right before I think she I come to the Lord, so I think she was the one who prayed for me. I'll find out. Let's pray again. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. We thank you, Lord, for the wonderful feeling and the sense of your spirit is here this morning. Pray, Lord, that it continues to move among us and may we open our hearts up to your word. Not be hardened hearted, Lord, but be willing to listen to what you have to say to us. It's not me, it's not my words. I'm the spokesman, maybe. It's your words, Lord. And may we open up our hearts, our spirits to you, and not just be listeners, Lord, but be doers of what we're here to know in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, really, I think I might as well not bother preaching this morning because. So we're about prayer. We're quite kind of professional prayers, aren't we, at the moment?
Yeah.
It's great. I love it. And it is fantastic news for Sarah. I mean, we heard this last night that she's out of intensive care. She's on a normal ward. She's putting on weight. Her parents are with her. And it's just amazing. I mean, the girl's 3 years old, she had open heart surgery.
3 days.
Out.
It's now a week.
Yeah. And praise God for the physicians and the
Irons.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Amazing stuff. Mm. I don't know about you guys, but myself and Bettina, we like to watch the old police TV series. Who else likes watching the police TV series? One of the things you notice on the good ones, I must admit, I'm not biased, but I like the English ones and the Norwegian ones, to be honest, because they're pretty good. They're not all like glamorous people. You know, they're people with spots on their noses and so forth. And you always notice on these series, and if they're good and they're real, that when they get together in the morning, they have a briefing.
Yeah.
So the boss comes in, they all get around the table, and he tells them where we are so far, what's going on, what's been found out. And things on, it's quite exciting. And then he appoints different people to do different jobs. Okay, you do this, you do that, you go that, and off they go and move it out. And I think some of us who've probably worked with more than a few people have been used to that as well. I mean, when I worked as a mechanic, for example, my boss came in the morning, we was in the tea room, he'd come in the morning with the job cards, and he'd hang the jobs out to the ones that were best qualified to do their jobs. So like some guys were good at one thing and some guys will do it out of things. I used to do it when I was a service manager. I used to go and do exactly the same, go and hand it out. And you plan the day. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it'll be planned. And it was necessary, I think it's necessary to plan the day according to the person who's in charge. I mean, as a, let's put it as a grease monkey, which is what I was, a mechanic, I used to complain that, oh, I always got the same jobs. I used to go to my boss and say, why is it always me that's doing this? It's not fair. I'm always doing this job. And he'd say, just do your job, what you're paid for, and get on with it, and don't complain. And I'd like pout a little bit, and then I'd go in again a few weeks later and do the same thing, and he'd probably say the same thing. But eventually he sat me down and he said, look, the guy that I was complaining about that always gets the good jobs, he's good at that job. He said, it's my job to make sure that that vehicle comes in and goes out the same day without any problems, and he can do it. No one else in this workshop can do the way he does it. And it kind of then sunk in, and he said, the same reason I was always doing the electrical jobs and fault finding jobs, which took care of. And for the same reason, I give you them jobs, because I know that you're methodical, and you go through everything, and I don't have to say to the customer, you can get your car back tonight, but I know that when he does get it back, it'll be done. So I started to understand a little bit, I started to grow up, I suppose. And the boss sees the whole picture, yeah? But we didn't do it, but I don't. I know, it's just like all about me. But the boss sees the whole picture, sees the whole thing, the whole situation, like what's got to be done, when it's got to be done. He has an oversight into everything. Gives the right work to the right people with the right skills to complete the job. Things need to be ordered, otherwise it's going to be chaos. It's going to be crazy. And this happens, I think, in most aspects of working life, especially with a team. I mean, we watch the Formula One, and everyone focuses on the driver. But the driver isn't going to be good without the team. When that driver comes in and he needs his wheels changed, if that team's not a good team, then his wheels are not going to get changed properly, are they? If that driver isn't got the proper food inside him, or the team hasn't got the proper food inside him, and they've all got stomach bugs or, you know, oof, too chubby to lift the wheels up. You know what I mean? A team has to work as a team, and the team manager has to oversee the team to work as a team, and he assigns different people different jobs. So no one's more important than the guy that drives the truck. Mm-hmm. Because if the guy that drives the truck doesn't get the truck to the circuit, there can be no racing. Yeah. So everyone in a team is important, and we're a team. Mm-hmm. We're a team God, or whatever, team church, or whatever you want to call it. But we're a team, and you've all of us have got individual special skills, talents, gifts, and we've gone over this many times. And you're unique. God didn't make robots. God didn't decide to make a whole nation of people the same. Every single person is unique. Every single one of us is different. From your brother to your sister, whatever. And it's an amazing thing. Everyday lives, we need to plan ahead. Otherwise, we're going to have a mess. You waste time, eh? If you don't have any plan, you waste time. You know, what's it called? Procrastinate or something. I don't know what it is. You have to plan a time to wake up, time to eat, time to travel, time to get to work, time to go shopping. Otherwise, you're going to have no food in the cupboard. And we have to plan. We as parents do it for our kids when they're younger. We do everything for them. But we expect them, as they get older, to start to conceive and make plans for themselves. That's what we do. But one thing that we do as Christians, and we often overlook, and it's prayer. And it's vital. Many years ago, a friend of mine gave me a little tract, but I think I can read it then without glasses. It was a poem. And I found it on the internet the other day, but I couldn't read it anymore. And I used to have it in my wallet. I didn't have my wallet for years, I've lost it now. But this is what the poem says. I got up early one morning and rushed right into the day. I had so much to accomplish that I didn't have time to pray. Problems just tumbled about me, the heavier came each task. Why doesn't God help me, I wondered, and he answered. He didn't ask.
Yeah.
I wanted to see joy and beauty, but the day toiled on, grey and bleak. I wondered why God didn't show me, and he said, but you didn't see. I tried to come into God's presence, I used all the keys at the lock. God gently and lovingly chided my child. You didn't know. I woke up early this morning and I paused before entering the day. I had so much to accomplish that I had to take time to pray.
That's so good.
I had that in my wallet, and it was my kind of mantra for many years that whatever I did, I take some advice. So that's available on the internet. It's called Time to Pray. You can find it anywhere. I can put it on our Facebook thing and then we'll watch it as well. So prayer is our life source. Prayer is our connection. Prayer is our everything. Prayer should be the centre of our Christian life. And when we read through scriptures, we can see that there are conditions, as was mentioned this morning, that we need to fulfil in order to, if we want to see our prayers answered. And this is an overlook, and they just do not get it. It's like God is not some magic genie, you know, that you just go, God, I want this. You know, it doesn't work like that. We don't call upon God with a big wish list, you know, or want list, as it's called nowadays, I think. But a lot of us do. And I think a lot of us also, many times, we tell God what he should be doing, don't we? You know, or what he should be doing with someone else is quite common. Lord, you should speak to that person.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, you should tell them. Lord, you know, we do that, don't we? We tell God what to do, you know? Mm-hmm. As I told my boss what to do, and he said, do your job, put your pay shop, get on with it. And quite often, even sitting in the church, we sit here and then we hear a sermon or preaching and we think, oh, such and such should be here today. They should be listening to this. No, you should be listening to this. That's what you're here for. God's called you and appointed you here for this. So, there's certain conditions. He needs us to be faithful. We need to be faithful. We need to be faithful to him with the gifts, with the talents and the resources he's given us. And that includes the church, which is his body, his bride, his love. So we need to be responsible. He doesn't answer prayers of those who reject him. If you reject God, you don't answer your prayer. I don't expect him to be answered, I don't know. We cannot expect the Lord to answer prayer if we have unconfessed sin in our lives. Unconfessed sin is a little secret sins that no one knows about. When the door's closed, and there's no one else about. What goes on in the mind, and what you're watching on the internet or TV, and you think no one can see it. Well, the Bible tells me God's omnipresent, he's everywhere. He can see. He's sitting right next to you. That's one worth thinking about. We can't come to God if we're in disobedience. We can't expect God to answer prayers if we're not doing his will. Or if we're breaking the law. If, you know, we're deliberately going out of our way. For example, you can't say, Lord, I need to get home quick because of whatever reason, so let me drive 100 kilometres an hour and I'll get caught. Doesn't work that way. Today I want to just look at a few areas that we might require a little bit of tweaking in our prayer time. Just a few little bits. In 1 Peter 3:7, Jesus spoke. Sorry. 1 Peter 3:7. Likewise, you husbands, dwell with them with understanding, talk about husbands and wives, giving honour to the wife as the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. This is talking about husbands and wives, but generally it's talking about relationships. Get on with people. Get on. Don't be a pain. Don't be a deliberate nuisance. Don't cause a stumbling block. I mean, we know this. We understand this. Jesus speaks about this, about the speck in your eye and so forth. But we don't. And as Diane just said, criticism. Criticising people is judgmental. You're being judgmental of someone else when you criticise. And the Bible tells us not to judge. So God's not going to answer prayers of people that aren't at peace with each other. In family, it's vitally important. A husband and wife have got to be.
Yeah.
Right? They've got to be. Otherwise, you're not going to get your prayers answered. Family problems I would think 9 times out of 10 come from the fact that the husband and wife just won't get on. They can get on because they used to get on once upon a time when everything was all lovey-dovey-do. But now for some reason, there's an offence or something, and one won't give or the other won't give, and then what's it? Someone does something, and then someone's going to do this. He said that, so I'm going to say that. He went there, I'm going to go there. And this is stupidity, it's childish, but it's unfortunately real life. This is what happens. You pray something, get answered. There's arguing, there's bickering, there's fighting, there's in the home, and it's going to destroy it. Kids get messed up because of it. Families break up because of it. Because the husband and wife just would not get along. It says would not, not could not, they can, if they want. You know, husbands and wives can get on if they want. And the truth is, it's sinful not to, because we're called to be together. We're called to be in union. And the wonderful, amazing thing is that with Christ, that marriage problems can be overcome, as long as you're both in agreement. And that comes to being respectful of each other and respectful of and obedient to the word of God, to come before him with unconfessed sin. And sometimes not easy, but it's going to be done. In Matthew 18:19, this is Jesus speaking. Again, I say to you, that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. Again, the same principles, harmony. The model prayer. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. So we need to be forgiving people. Yeah, people do give you the number, okay? People will rub you up the wrong way. Christians, brothers and sisters, family, even worse. You sometimes be pulling your hair out. Why? Or you'll get fed up with always being the persecuted one. Well, you can take it. Because Jesus took worse than that for you. So you can take it. You can take a few bad words. There's a woman in Ephesians, in 4, Ephesians 4, 26 to 27, in the Amplified. Be angry at sin and immorality, at injustice and ungodly behaviour. Be angry at that. Okay? Not angry at each other, but angry at that. Yet do not sin. Do not let your anger cause you shame or allow it to last until the sun goes down. There's another bit to that, was there? No, another bit. And do not give the devil an opportunity to lead you into sin by holding a grudge, war. Or nurturing anger, war. Or harboring resentment, war. Or cultivating bitterness. Look at the words there. There, it's, if anything you want to know about prayer, it's all there. In that one verse, yeah. Don't give the devil an opportunity. In one word it says, don't give him a foothold. To lead you into sin by holding a grudge. See? Lead you into sin. So holding a grudge is a sin. Sinful people don't get prayers answered. This is where we're going. Or nurturing anger, or harboring resentment, or cultivating bitterness. Drop it. Drop it. Be more mature. Harmony. Get to this harmony place. Once you live in harmony with your family, once you live in harmony with your brothers and sisters and the people around you, life is much better. Isn't it? You can tell when you walk into a household where the family is not in harmony, can't you? You can walk in and feel the atmosphere. It's like, you know, and you can't wait to get out. But you can also tell the difference when you walk into a family that everyone's like in harmony. And it's nice. It's just wonderful. Actually, when I first started diving over here, we had to get our tanks filled from the Finnish Dive Centre in Askaiatis. And there were such lovely people. It was calm, it was relaxed, and I don't know if you've heard Finnish people speak. They speak a bit like penguin. But they like sing to each other. It's such a lovely language. It's so, you know, I couldn't understand the word they're saying, but there'd be one at the back doing the bottles, and the boss would be saying, what are you going to do? I used to sit there and just get a coffee, and there was all called Tino, Nemo, Dino, whatever I was. There was laughing, and I was just sitting there, and the guy, the big guy, just laugh. He was laughing all the time. Oh, who's this? He goes, and oh, the vault's on last night. And I sat there on the coffee, and I said, I love coming down here. It's such a friendly place. And it was just, you felt good when you came back.
Just happy.
They were nice people. And it was just a nice atmosphere, and it makes a difference. Mm-hmm. Whereas you walk in somewhere else, and it's like, what do you want? I don't have time for that now, but you have to come back tomorrow. You know,
yeah.
Does it make a difference?
Yeah, it does.
And that's what some homes are like, some houses are like,
yeah.
You know, it's like, well, if you want to say, what do you do, so. You know what I mean? And we need to live in harmony. We need to be in harmony with our family, we need to be in harmony with our church family. We need to be in harmony inside and outside your workplace, especially because we are called to be lights. Let your light shine before others. Aggressive, miserable, bitter, lonely person, aren't you? It's not a particular light. And you may say to someone, oh, let me pray for you. And they say, yeah, thank you. And you pray for me, but nothing happens. It's because of your lonely, bitter attitude, you haven't had your prayer heard or answered. Another verse I love is Hebrews 4:16. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace in the time of need. Doesn't mean you've got to go. I need your help. Please. And I need it now. Even my friends who don't believe have said this to me. I called out to God and I believe he heard me. Could that happen? And I said, yeah, God hears. I think God answers the prayers personally more of unbelievers than believers sometimes, because the unbeliever is the one who's really going, hey, I really need help. And we're going, well, can you do this, can you do that, can you do that, I need this and I need that, and can you sort that out, can you talk to him, can you talk to her, can you do that, and I need this and I need more money. Or we do the opposite, don't we? Oh, I can't believe God with that. I shouldn't be bothering God with that. He wants to be involved in your life. He wants to be involved in every area. So we can boldly enter the throne room. Look at Esther. Her husband was the king, and the king called for people when he wanted them. He had lots of wives. But when she saw a situation that was going to be very serious, she went before the king. She could have been killed for that. How dare you come before me? But she went before the king. But Moses, we spoke about him the other week, 80 years old, and his brother, 84 years old, with a stick, let my people go. But he went before the Pharaoh, the most powerful man in the world at the time. Boldly, be bold. Be bold in your prayers.
Amen.
Be bold in your prayers. Amen. Don't give him a wish list. Don't sit there with a lot of I want, I want, I want, I want. But think before you speak. Think before you pray. I think a lot of us sometimes trip up on this one because we're usually talking to bosses or bigger people, and we have that fear of rejection or belittlement or inferiority. You don't have to be like that. God loves you. He loves you so much, and he's a father. And what father would turn away his son or his daughter when they come to him for help? It's the most common thing you do as a parent. Dad, I broke this. You don't know why you're stupid. Well, that's it, right away. Maybe after the 20th, 30th time, I don't know. You take it and you fix it. And that's what God does. But you need to be in harmony. You need to have no fear. I'm going to his presence, amen.
Amen.
I need to tap on the door. You have to wake him up. Alright? You don't have to ring a bell to wake God up. He's not sleeping. He's awake. He's ready. He's waiting, actually. Whenever you pray, you're going to always be welcomed. Yeah, as a good boss would say to his staff, my door is always open.
Yeah.
And that's how I say it with our guys. His door is always open. You can walk in any time and say, Lord, I need your help. The other thing I think we do as well, and this is common for all of us, isn't it? We give up too easy.
Absolutely. Yeah.
We've got to be persistent in our prayers. And sometimes, I don't know, maybe we pray two or three times. That's why this week I kept us updated with everything that was going on, so that you could keep praying. You know, you could see the results of your prayers, and I think, as again we mentioned this morning, when you see the results of your prayers, it encourages you to keep praying. And so we saw that amazing thing this morning. Another thing that we've been praying for really since this church was founded,
years.
Yeah, 4 or 5 years now, was our SIF number.
Oh.
Okay, we've done everything.
Yeah.
We've paid my mark before he left. Paid a lot of money. We've done a lot of time, put in a lot of hours, but it wasn't good enough. So we reapplied and we waited and waited. Well, praise God, this Friday we got it. It means a big thing. It's a big thing to have your SIF number as a church, because they don't like evangelical churches here in the towns, okay?
And it's the definite one.
It's a definite SIF number. It's not a temporary one, it's a real one. Mm-hmm. So, God answers prayer, but we've been persistent. Praying every day for 3 years? 4 years? For the SIF number. So that's one we can tick off the list. So be persistent in your prayers. In Luke 11:5-9, we read this. And he said to them, Jesus, which of you shall have a friend and go to him at midnight and say to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves? For a friend of mine has come to me and on his journey, and I have nothing to set before him. And he will answer from within and say, do not trouble me. The door is now shut and my children are with me in bed. They cannot rise and give it to you. I say to you, though he will not rise and give to him because he is his friend, yet because of his persistence, he will rise and give him as many as he needs. So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. That's the last one, I think, yeah? Can you imagine that? So you've got a friend who's turned up, you go to the baker, knock on his door, goes, peel off, I'm in bed. My friend, so we need something. And I don't. I need some food. But peel off. Don't hang on, I need some food. Eventually he's going to get up and go, look, take the sack. Isn't it? Kind of. And this is what Jesus says. Don't see an answer. Just because you can't see it happening doesn't mean to say it isn't happening. The thing that tells me sometimes, because I'm one of the worst for this, she says to me, when you pray, God says to his angels, for example, okay, this is what needs to be done. Because there's power in the words, yeah?
There's
power in the words. God spoke and it happened, so there's power in the words. And then you say, that's never going to happen, God probably says, okay, come back now. So the angels will come back. And then you sit down again and you pray and he goes, oh, okay, back out again. Can you imagine how confused my angels must be? What's he up to today? Come on. Is he going? Is he not going? Is he going to do this or not going to do this? And it's, I can see it, you know, I have to visualize these things. And you've got to be persistent. Because these angels are like, I can imagine walking down, I don't know, like a pathway. And they're getting halfway down the pathway and then I'm going, oh, well, what's the point? I might as well give up. And then, okay. And then I start praying again because I get back in faith. And they go, okay, let's get back down. You know, I want to keep them angels walking towards me. I want to keep them coming down. So we're going to keep on. So we need to be persistent. We've got to be persistent in our prayers. There have been things that so many Christians have prayed for years and years, maybe. But God in his time has answered. And maybe you'll never see the manifestation of the prayer. Maybe you're praying for someone, and you're thinking, every day you're praying for them, and they don't seem to be responding to the Lord. And then you shuffle off this earth, but something happens to them, and they come to the Lord, and then when you get in the glory, they come up to you and say, amen.
Yeah.
Must have been you that you prayed for me, because you're the only Christian that I know. Well, I'll come to Jesus in 2038 or something. Keep on praying, keep pushing in. Don't give up just because you don't see results. But when you do see results, let that encourage your faith. God will answer this time. It's not that he doesn't want to answer. And also, he asks for the wrong things, don't we? Sometimes. We may not think it's the wrong thing, but like a kid sees, we've done this many times before, but a kid sees matches as pretty. Ooh. Yeah? I want that. We don't give it to them because we know.
Yes.
Sometimes we might be trying to get a box of matches.
Yeah.
But we don't know. We think, ooh, that's what I really want. I really want that. And God's going, no, you don't. That's going to hurt you. That's going to harm you. That's not coming your way. We may not be ready for it. Yeah? Or it just may be something that's going to cause us harm, not something that does us any good. I'm sure many of us know. I've known a few Christians that have prayed for businesses, especially back in the UK, a while back, and they wanted just a little bar or something, and then they end up in the same problem they were when they got saved, because they're surrounded by alcohol all the time. And, it's okay to be an innkeeper. They can reason all that, and they get the bar, and then we speak to them a few years later, and they're back on drinking again, and it's like, well, isn't that what you're saying for? Ah, no, it's okay, I can control it. It's foolish. And then God closes doors, but sometimes we jump through windows. That's what we've got to be careful of. So be persistent in your prayer, but make sure your prayer life is right. Make sure you're fulfilling the conditions that we've already spoke about this morning. Our persistence shows faith in God. And he's promised to answer our prayers. When we come before him with clean hands, clean heart, and a clean conscience, that's what you need to get your prayers answered. Prayers do make a difference. And be bold. Church, now's the time to be bold. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Speak to people, probably that you know that are going through difficult times, and just simply, if it's a family member or a friend that you've not spoken to for a while, I'll say to them, would you like to pray? Okay. If they say no, then fine. Pray for anyone. But most of the time they say, yeah. Yes, please. Thank you. Even the most unbelieving friends of mine, I've said to them recently, because everyone's going through a tough time, would you like me to pray? Yes, please. What hurt harm can it do? That's no harm at all. We're called to be a praying people. So therefore, let's dedicate and set time aside to pray. Let's be obedient. We can read through the scriptures. We can read just about any scripture, and it tells us about praying. Okay, he's new beginnings every morning. He nurses are new each morning. He loves you. He loves you so much. But he wants to give you these promises, and he wants you to live in these promises. Just got to make a priority. Prayer has got to be the priority. But I want to finish with an old gospel song this morning. So you remember, because sometimes it's better to remember things through singing than it is to remember through the words. So if you'd like to stand. And I think you may know this song. But in Sunday school, we normally teach the children through song. Yeah. In fact, I never went to Sunday school particularly, but I used to teach at Sunday school sometimes. And I only learned the 66 books of the Bible through a Sunday school song. And sometimes when we sing it, it goes in here and it goes in here a bit easier. So this is an old song called What a Friend We Have in Jesus. And we did ask it was slightly different to ours originally done. problems, any trials, any temptations, take it to the Lord in prayer. He's there 24/7.
Amen.
Day, night, good times, bad times.
Yep.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine down upon you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. And goodbye to everybody online. Thank you for joining us. God bless you. Have a great week. God bless you all. It's a good old chestnut, sorry.